Well, thanks for coming. My talk is about pups and the Pribilofs and the Cunningham Award that I won, the opportunity I had to go to St. Paul, Alaska. So the journey basically started in July of 2009 when we became the largest institution to have northern fur seals. We have 6 northern fur seals here, 2 males and 4 females. This is Baranov. And they came to us earlier than July of 2009, but we opened the New Balance Foundation Marine Mammal Center in July of that year. And that was really when we had an amazing opportunity to show off these animals and start what we hope to be a breeding population here. So this is a better opportunity to see the whole exhibit and what it looks like now. And it really spurred me to apply for the Cunningham Award. And if you want to know more about that, feel free to ask me after the talk. And basically, it was just because these animals, there's only 12 in the country, and they look a lot like a sea lion, but they behave a lot differently. We heard a lot of different things about training them and how hard it is to train them and how quickly they forget things. And we found that to not really be the case. They are pretty amazing animals, but just in general, we did know a limited amount about them. And so I would love to have the opportunity to learn more. And so I started researching studies that were done on northern fur seals. And found that they do a lot of research off the coast of Alaska, specifically on St. Paul Island, where they spend a majority of their breeding season. And so I applied for that and was lucky enough to get the award last year, which allowed me to go on this whole journey that you're going to find out more about. So if you've never had the opportunity to get up close with our northern fur seals and you want to help distinguish them and maybe help our public learn a little bit more about them, northern fur seals are part of the Otariae family, and that is composed of northern fur seals and sea lions. There are 9 fur seal families, or 9 fur seal species, and 5 sea lion species. Fur seals and sea lions are very commonly confused, and oftentimes our females are mistaken for babies because there's such a huge size difference between the males and the females. So the things that you can point out that'll help people distinguish them from animals like harbor seals, which we also have, are these tiny little ear flaps they have on the side of their head. And this is something they also have in common with the sea lion. They're called pinnae. They also have really large front flippers, and that's what they're going to use to swim with. And if you come to our exhibit right now, you'll see pretty frequently Justin is training Isaac, one of our fur seals, to porpoise. He's also training him to do a front flipper stand, and you'll see the massive power these animals have in their front shoulders because of the fact that they use those front flippers for swimming. Whereas our harbor seals move with their hind flippers. So when they move on land, they slug along like an inchworm, and they'll move their hind flippers from side to side. But because these animals are so strong in their front flippers, they can actually support their whole body and do a front flipper stand. So you should definitely check out a training session when Justin's here. It's really cool to watch that behavior. This is Baranov at his largest. Before we built our brand new exhibit, he came to us for a summer and decided that he wanted to sleep on the tiniest space we had on our exhibit. And he was about 500 pounds at the time, and he made the bridge bow in the middle because he was so large. And so this is a huge example of sexual dimorphism, because the males can be up to 600 pounds, and the females are about 120 at the most. So there's a big difference between the two of them in size. And this has to do with the fact that males during breeding season will haul out on land. And so for about 3 to 4 months, they'll spend their entire life on land using their blubber as a food source, so they don't have to give up their territory, and so that other males won't be able to take over their space. Whereas the females will go out to sea a couple of times a week, so they're much smaller. They're up to about 120 pounds. So if you ever see someone out there talking about our animals and saying, oh, look at the baby, you can help educate them as to why they are smaller and explain that to people. So to give you a little background as to where you would find these animals, there are 2 different areas where they typically will spend their breeding season and their migration times. They breed all the way up off the coast of Alaska. So if you look way up here, this is their breeding season off the coast of Alaska, and then this off the coast of Russia is where they spend their breeding season as well. So these are the Commander Islands, and then these are the Pribilof Islands. So this is where a lot of the research is done in the U.S. And then throughout the rest of the year when they're not doing their breeding, they'll migrate south. And they migrate as far south as the coast of California down to San Miguel Island for the U.S. population. And then they'll also migrate for the Russian population as far south as Japan. And so what they do is they follow the food concentration. So they'll travel along with the food, and that's why they move as much as they do throughout the course of that year. So specifically for their breeding sites, there's 3 different islands. St. Paul and St. George are the most frequently visited by the population on the U.S. side. And then Bogusloff Island as well. So a majority of the research is done on St. Paul and St. George. And Bogusloff is kind of a side island. And then San Miguel as well, down off the coast of California. So the thing that really helps distinguish a fur seal from an animal like a sea lion is really their fur coat, and that's what we point out a lot with our animals here at the aquarium. If you see a cross-section of their fur, underneath what's really hard to see is actually this peach layer, and that's called underfur. So if you ever see our animals grooming a lot or dried out, you probably won't even get to see it because their fur is so thick. But the guard hair is up on top, which is that dark hair on the top of it, is basically what you'll always see, and that prevents water from getting through to the underfur. And we tell this reference, usually I say it as part of my training session, where if you make an okay sign with your hand, or other people will reference it as about the space of a quarter, they have 300,000 hairs in that space on their body. And that's how they're able to stay warm. So they don't really need the blubber for the warmth, they really need that fur. So it's really important for them to groom a lot. And it's another thing that the public thinks is really interesting about them. They always think that they're itchy, but they're actually just grooming their fur to keep it in good condition. So to show you that, this is Isaac when he was at the Mystic Aquarium for the past couple months, showing you his grooming. So he goes from being really smooth, and in just a couple of motions, he gives himself a pretty good ear to you. So he can be pretty frequently seen looking like that on our exhibit, especially this morning. He was hauled out and he had this huge mane on the top of his head. So that's how frequently you can see them grooming and how long their guard hairs are, especially his. His tend to be a lot longer than even Baranov's are as well. So unfortunately for these animals, because they had this really unique feature, they were hunted. In 1786, a gentleman by the name of Gabriel Pribilof brought a crew of Alaska Natives out to the Pribilof Islands. And the islands had already been discovered in the past, but they just weren't utilized. And so he went out and rediscovered them because he knew that there was a lot of wealth on those islands in the form of fur seals. And so he established these islands, left people on the islands to start a fur seal breeding, or a fur seal harvesting population. At the time, they believed that there was a fur seal population of about 2 to 3 million animals. And during the first year, they took about 40,000 animals. There wasn't a ton of people on these islands, so it was a pretty limited ability that they had to take a large number of animals. But it wasn't regulated at all. So they started a company called the Russian American Company, and they began this fur trade industry. At the time, they were able to get about $4 per pelt, which if you think about the 1800s, that was a huge sum of money. And the fur seal had the second thickest coat of any marine mammal, so it was really a very sought after product. Crews would live there for a few years at a time, and then in the 1820s, permanent settlements were established so that people could live there for their life, or if they wanted to, they could come back and forth, but it became a really lucrative business. So in the 1860s, the U.S. realized how lucrative this place was, and they purchased Alaska. It's estimated, again, that from the late 1700s until 1860, about 2.5 million fur seals were harvested. So they became incredibly good at doing this. They would not only harvest these animals on the island, but also out in the ocean. And this was a big problem because they would try and take these animals in the water, but if they were unsuccessful, these animals would sink. They just had no means of successfully culling all of these animals. And so it was a really problematic process. The one thing that was really cool, though, was that some of these establishments, you could still see the remnants of them on St. Paul. And so it's hard to see, it's a little bit dark, but this is the remnant of a settlement, so a barabara, which was basically built out of whalebone. They would use whale vertebra as the bases of the house, and they would use whale rib bones as the roof. So they would dig it down into the earth so that it was basically warm, providing its own kind of heat system, and then they would use whalebone to support it. And so this is basically the basement of the house, and you can still see some of the whalebone that was left there. So it was just pretty awesome that 150 years later you can still see some of the settlements. So Alaska was purchased by the U.S. for $7.2 million, which was a huge sum then, but the fact that over the course of 25 years the U.S. recovered that purchase price just showed that they knew exactly what they were doing, and that was just $7.2 million in fur seal pelts. So not the other industries that they discovered in Alaska, that was just fur seal pelts alone. And so they were able to monopolize the pelt industry by purchasing Alaska. In subsequent decades, the U.S. would make over $50 million in revenue from fur seal skins. In 1911, the northern fur seal was placed under international management. They realized that they were causing a problem. The population was dwindling at a huge rate, and they decided that they needed to do something about it. So they signed a treaty with Great Britain, Japan, and Russia, guaranteeing them a certain population of pelts. And that way, it reduced illegal harvesting. Other countries were coming in and harvesting these animals out in the ocean so that they weren't visible to the U.S., and so that the U.S. didn't know that they were coming in and doing this, but it was causing a huge decline in the population. So then in 1957, a new treaty was signed, and this actually allowed for the harvest of adult females. They felt that there was too many adult males that were just hanging out, if you will, on the islands. They weren't breeding animals, and they felt like this was going to be a problem because it was going to cause overfishing on the part of the fur seal. So they felt if they harvested a certain number of females, they would reduce the amount of breeding at the time, and it would result in an incline in population. And it wasn't a widely received idea, and out in the end, it ended up causing a huge decline for the next 10 years. So clearly wasn't a well thought out plan. By the 1970s, the harvest was reduced to about 25,000 subadult males per year. And over that time, and since then, the population has continued to decline, which is why there's so much research being done on these animals, because they can't figure out why that decline has continued, because the population harvesting has been discontinued, and yet the population still continues to decline today. The commercial harvest was totally and completely ended in 1984. It was a commercial harvest that was supported by the United States government, and so it was funded by the government, and it was the main means of income for people on the island. The Aleut population was the Native American population living on that island, and it was the main means of income for a majority of the people living there. So you have to understand that for people living on this island 400 miles off the coast of Alaska, they had income at 1 minute, and then the next year the government decided they weren't going to fund it anymore, and that was it. The doors were closed. And so it was a really difficult time for people living there because the U.S. just walked away from it. So for 2 years, the Aleut population tried to run it on their own, and then they abandoned it altogether. And so the only harvest that continues to this day is a subsistence harvest for the Aleut population, and they only harvest about 400 animals a year, and that's regulated by the U.S. government. They do watch what's going on, and they only take subadult males, which are about 2 to 4 years old. So St. Paul Island is a pretty small island. It's only about 40 square miles, and these are the breeding sites that are all labeled out there. There's 14 total. And we would visit every single one of them during our research trip. We would have to count all of the fur seal pups on those islands, or on those harvesting sites rather, and then we would also have to check out how many males were there. So the first thing that would happen is that researchers would go out there and count how many adult males were on each spot. Then the subsistence harvest would happen only on specific sites, and then we would go out and we would do the shearing of the pups after that. So to give you a perspective, St. Paul Island had a population at one time of 438 people, and when we went there, it was actually only 350 people. So slowly over time, people were heading off the island. There really isn't much in the form of income. There's one grocery store, there's one restaurant, if you will, which is in the fish plant, there's one church. There's just very little in the form of an economy. So many people are starting to leave the island, and it's being overcome basically by the fur seal. The fur seal population numbers in the hundreds of thousands there, and they take over a majority of the ocean spots on the island. The one tourist trade they do have is the bird industry. There's a lot of birders who come there, and it's a really cool place because there's tons of birds that you can see, and as you can see, there's 203 species of them. So these were my bosses. This is Rod and Rolf. They both have doctorates, and I spoke with them for hours and hours before going out there, trying to get a lot of information from them, and I was really interested in meeting them. I was expecting them to be, you know, these very staunch professional gentlemen, and then coming out to meet them in these gasoline suits, it was really interesting. So they were really awesome guys, and I can't talk enough about them. They were so great at teaching us. So our first day out there, we actually were in trucks driving out across the island, and you heard the animals before you saw them. So I just wanted to give you a perspective of what it was like to meet the northern fur seals out there. It was just a really cool opportunity to experience them. Oh. had a chance to get out of the truck. This is what it looked like. It was a pretty awesome experience for me, coming from having six animals here to going over a ledge and having too many animals to count. So most people who were on the trip had already experienced this, so this was kind of second nature, but there was three of us who were volunteers who had never had this opportunity before, and I think we're all pretty awestruck by the overall experience. And there was a lot of respect you had to have as well, because you know, the big guy over on the right looks a lot like Baranoff, but obviously was not nearly as happy to see us as Bear. So pup shearing was the main reason that we were there, and when I spoke with Dr. Gillette, who was the head of the study, that was why he was taking on volunteers. It's a huge task that requires up to 15 people, and the goal is to shear 10% of the population that they estimated was born 2 years before. So in 2008, the population was estimated at 102,000 animals. So we were sent out there to shear basically 10,250 pups, which is an amazing task because we needed to do it in 5 days with 15 people. There were 14 sites that we had to cover, and this was our whole group. So it was kind of a motley crew of people who had done it before, people who had never done it, me being one of them, and people who had done it for a year or two. So they were excellent at training us. The one thing that was the hardest is that here at the aquarium, when we train people, we train, Bailey, our volunteer, can speak to this, we train you three times. So you don't get just sent out there and do it. With these guys, they went out there, they showed you one time, and they said, here you go, and you just ran into it and got started. So it was a really interesting learning experience. And this was the gear that we wore. Just the most interesting part of the trip was getting yourself ready. You had to have every part of that gear. If you missed one part of that gear, you would know it, and you would pay for it for the entire day. You had your shears to shear off the guard here, off the top of the pup's head. And we tried, I guess in the past they tried using electric shears, but they found that it would get caught with dirt and sand and it would break very frequently. So they decided that good old shears, the manual kind, were the best ones to use. So that's what we stuck with. You would have a little satchel for it on your side. You had gauntlets for your arms because the pups had incredibly sharp teeth, and if you gave them the opportunity to bite you, they would. So you needed to protect your arms. You had gloves so that when you held onto the pup, again, you would be protected. Knee pads so that you could kneel on the rocks. You're going to see that this terrain is incredibly uneven, and those knee pads would be really important. And then the most important part was this awesome hat that I had. And it was also the cause of a lot of laughter because I showed up and I looked like a giant Q-tip. But one of the last things I packed was Paul said before I ran out the door, like, don't you want to bring a hat? And I was like, oh, good point. Just thinking that, you know, while I was out and about not doing the actual research, I should have a hat with me. So I grabbed a hat, threw it in my bag, and it turned out to be the greatest thing I've had because it kept the hair out of your face so you're not wiping sand and dirt in your face while you're out working with the animals. And that hat I still have to this day, and it's still white, but everybody made fun of it, so. So the method for shearing, the senior members who have been working with these animals for sometimes as much as 20 years will move the males and the females down to the water line. And usually when we come over the edge, there's a lot of shouting and that'll move the females down. And then we have a pole that the senior staff will bang on the rocks. And usually that's enough that it'll send the males down to the water line. Once all of that's done, the pups will stay up on the rocks like this little guy here. They're not able to swim yet, so they won't head down to the water with the adults. And they usually are in groups, which is perfect for us so that we can have access to them to shear them. Basically, what happens is the next group of staff in line will figure out exactly how many pups are in that group, and they'll shout out a number. And that number lets you know exactly how many pups you have. You have a little hang tag that you use to count off exactly how many pups you've sheared. So if they say five, you need to go in there and grab a pup, move out, hold it between your legs, shear off that fur in a really accurate way. It needs to be about the size of an index card, and then you let that pup go and go in for another one. And it's an insane task because these pups are about 10 pounds. So you have to be gentle, but you have to be firm because if you're too loose with them, they're just gonna turn around and chew your arm up. But at the same time, you need to be careful with them because they are babies. So it's really important and requires a lot of skill that I definitely did not have. So if you're new to the task, what happens is you say, you know, they say go get five, and you're lucky if you get three. And so the other people who are ahead of the game and, you know, had five before you've got two will help you and pick up the slack. So I had a lot of slack in the first couple of days for sure.
So this is what I call the terrain of terror. The senior staff members would move all of the animals down to the water line, and then once they shouted out the number, they would just say go. And you would have to run like a jackrabbit down these rocks to the pups, because the goal is to be as least disruptive as possible. So you want to get in there, do what you need to do, and then move down to the next site. And so you had to run down these slippery rocks with boots that I just couldn't stand. I thought they were the slipperiest boots ever, but people swear by them. And you go in, grab the pups, and get out of the way. So this was pretty much what the terrain looked like around the whole coast of St. Paul. So you can see why these animals really need to be able to walk on all fours, because animals would be all the way up to the top of this rock area. So that's what a pup would look like when it was done. He was obviously not happy with us. But you would want a really clear patch, because the senior staff would go back out and count these pups as soon as we were done shearing the entire, all of the rookeries, all 14 of them. And so it had to be a really clear patch. And that's the underfur that you can see underneath. So you didn't shave them completely bald. And they also would not go swimming with that bald head. They would molt one time before they went out into the ocean. So about 3 months old, they would molt, and they would be called silver coats. They had a really bright silver-colored coat before they went out. And then at about 4 months, they would leave, and then they would stay out in the ocean for about 2 years. So a lot of people were concerned when I've talked in the past, so you just shaved them bald and you sent them out into the water. But no, they actually get a brand new beautiful coat before they head out there. So we had some pretty cool hang time with these animals. If we were moving on to the next section, they would tell us to stay back, and then they would move on and clear the next area. So it was really fun, because we'd have an opportunity once in a while to sit in a space where there was a pup just kind of hanging out next to us, and this little guy happened to be one of them. And you learned very quickly to have a lot of respect for these fur seals, because they would go from next to yellow 1 second to really angry. So it's like calm. We also had time to observe the overall harem structure of the animals. So you would see groups of males and females. Sometimes you would see a male with only a single female, or a male with as many as 25 females. It would be really hard to figure out what that male brought to the table that brought that many females, but it was really awesome to see all of that. And then at the same time, you would see all of the females and the male, but you would also see all of the pups hanging out together as well. So the females, unless they were actually nursing the pups, didn't seem to spend a ton of time with their pups, but they still had that bond where the mothers were able to identify their pups, and I'll show you that in a little while. So we were able to get, or I was able to get from the researchers, a quick estimate on the results of our study. And in 2010, they estimated that 93,627 pups were born, and that was a pretty rapid decrease from the year before. It was an 8.8 decrease, whereas from 1998 until now, it's been about a 5.5% decrease. So the trend is continuing on the decline, and actually more so than it has been in the past 10 years. So to give you a little bit of an idea of what that looks like, just the past 10 years alone is just a very, very steep decrease. And there's a lot of theories about that, one of them being overfishing, and that seems to be the dominant theory, is that the pollock fishery is taking a lot of the fish that the females would normally be going out and feeding on. So that seems to be the biggest theory on why these animals are not breeding as much as they used to be, or why the animals are not successfully surviving. So there's a couple of other things we're able to do. I was there for 3 weeks, and so the first 5 days was the resighting that we did, or the tag, the shearing that we did. The second thing that I got to do, which was really awesome, was tag sighting. And so a lot of the females are tagged at the end of the pupping season with a yellow tag right in their flipper. And it allows us to see what site fidelity these animals have if they come back to the same place every year. And so a team of two researchers is hired every summer, and they're tasked with capturing the tag information. So they go out to this area called Paulovina Cliffs, and they basically spend every day just staring at the same location to see how many tags they can sight, how many females come up from the water with these tags on. And it provides a lot of really awesome information. And this is the area. And all those little boxes are actually the spaces where the researchers will go inside that box, and they can see right over the cliff to look at the females without disturbing the environment.
And so this is what a tag would look like. It's just a small yellow tag that the females wear. And they should have it on both flippers. And if that's the case, it's pretty easy to see it because it's bright enough. But you would be surprised because these animals a lot of times will tuck their flippers up underneath them. And so you will stare at one spot for sometimes as much as 10 or 15 minutes because you'll have that 1 second of an opportunity where a female will move off of another female and you'll have that quick view of a tag. And so you try and get as much information as possible. And so I put on the blog a while back this view, and that's about the size of it that you would see just with the naked eye. And there was 3 tags in there, but these animals have a really yellow coloration, so what seems like really obvious when you're up close all of a sudden blends in with their coat. And so we had a lot of binoculars, really high-powered binoculars that we would use to try and view them. So it was a really cool project. I really enjoyed that part of it. And the other part of it that we had an opportunity to do was observe a lot of the animal vocalizations. So we would get to watch the pups and experience. And this one is not working. There's supposed to be, let me see if I can grab this. There was supposed to be a pup vocal on here. The coolest thing that we got to do was observe the pups vocalizing and also the mothers interacting with the pups. Let me see if I can pull up, the vocalizations of these animals, because for me that was the coolest thing. I don't know how to use an Apple computer either, so bear with me. Has a unique call, and her pup would have a unique reply. And if you watch the video, she's calling for quite a long time, and you know, it's kind of self-explanatory, but one thing that I just find to be amazing is the fact that this pup and this mother, who have very little bonding time because these pups are maybe 3 weeks old, are able to find each other with very limited exposure to each other. So I'll play it so you can hear.
bond between the mother and the pup. It took her about 4.5 minutes to wake him up, and my parents were here for the aquarium lecture I gave, and I feel like that's what they had to deal with when they woke me up in the morning for school. Another thing that we did was female tagging, and this was a much more intense experience in terms of capturing a female. They'd have to go out with a net and restrain her, and then they would put a tag on her back, and this was a GPS tag, which was awesome because they were able to get so much information from her. She would give them information on how far out she went to sea, how many days she was gone from St. Paul, how deep she dove, and each tag cost $5,000. And they would put these tags on only only animals that had pups with them, because they actually would take the tag off the mother before she went out to sea the final time once she weaned her pup. And so we would go out I think they chose 4 different sites, and they would tag 3 different females at each site and put these tags on. And it was just really crucial because this will give us a lot of information to figure out if it really is prey that they're searching for further out to sea, and if overfishing is a huge problem that they need to look into. So it was really cool to be a part of that for a day. The hardest part that we dealt with was the mortality assessment, and this was one of the last things we did on the trip, and one of the things that we didn't really talk about, and I didn't know was coming when I went. And it was an integral part of the trip, because when we do the pup counts and when we do the pup shearing, we don't shear pups that have passed away. So when we go out there, there are pups that we pass over when we're doing all of the shearing, and we need to know how many pups were actually born. We have to count every single pup, dead or alive. So we went out to 4 different sites, and we had to count those pups, and they extrapolate that over the course of the entire island. So at 2 locations, what we had to do as well is actually remove the dead pups from that space, because they were going to go back out when they go and do further research at the end of September, and they were going to recount to see how many pups had passed away during that, I think it's like a 7-week time span. And then that information would then further figure out mortality over the course of the first 2 months of life. So it basically would allow, you know, for another phase of study. And so this is our group. We called ourselves the A team. There's the A team, the B team. And we had these little sticks, and these sticks had kitty litter in them, and then we would mark each pup so that we didn't double count them. And that would give us the information that we needed on pup mortality. And then the very last thing that we did was weights and measures. And this was, I thought, the most taxing part of the trip. We had these baby gates, and they were basically pup baby gates. They would send the pups up the flat part of the island. We would move them around these baby gates, and we would bring about 100 pups up at a time, and then we would weigh and measure them. And we would do about 225 to 250 animals at 3 different sites. And the buckets were what we used to weigh them in, and then the little boards, we would put them on the board to figure out how long they were. And at this point, they were 4 to 5 weeks old, and a lot of them were what we called milk monsters. They were really fat. And so they usually picked on the newer people, which was me, and they would give you the fat ones, and they were like really, really strong. So, you know, the senior staff would go grab one, and they would hand it to you, and it was your job to get the fat guy in the bucket, and then take him from the bucket, and then put him on the board, and he's squirming around, and you had to hold him gently but firmly so you could figure out how long he was, and then let him go, and I was exhausted by the end of it. This was a really cool time, too, because during the course of this whole trip, I had an opportunity to meet a lot of the people who lived on the island, and these people were really welcoming. I did a presentation about the animals that we had here, just to introduce them to a different version of a fur seal that they obviously wouldn't see on the island. And then we met this guy, this is John, and he's not choking this pup, I swear, he's just holding him. And John was, he's I think like 25 years old, and he's an Aleut native. He lived on the island his whole life, and he really wanted to participate and help out in any way possible. And so he came out and helped us with the weights and measures. And he's a big guy, but he's the biggest teddy bear you'll ever meet. And this was like the perfect opportunity for him to help us, because he could pick up the heaviest pup, and it was like, you know, a loaf of bread for him. So it was great for him to help us out. And this picture just kind of puts what you can't say in words out there, because he was just so happy to participate and help us out, despite the way the pup seems to be reacting. So the pups, 3 to 5 weeks old. I think that some of them were up to 6 weeks old. We didn't have the 2004 the 2010 values, but the 2004 values. Already you can show or see the sexual dimorphism in the animals. The males are up to 9 kilograms, and females are almost 8 kilograms.
and they're actually a little bit larger in 06, so hopefully I'll have the new values fairly soon. So that pretty much wrapped up the trip. I just wanted to thank a few people who gave me the opportunity to go. Susan Thompson and John Dayton helped me apply for the Cunningham. They reviewed my proposal over and over again, all the little bits and pieces that gave me the opportunity to go. Overall, the whole Cunningham committee for actually accepting my proposal and allowing me to go in the first place. Kathy and Jenny, my bosses, for not balking at the fact that I was going to be gone for a whole month, and my entire department because I was gone for the month of August, which for our department is one of the busiest months of the year, and they never complained at all to me, so I appreciate that. And then Paul Leonard and my family for all of their support as I got ready to go and dealing with all of my nerves. And then Dr. Gillette and all of the National Marine Mammal Laboratory for their support and being so open and being amazing trainers. And then I just wanted to conclude, I took tons and tons of video and I couldn't compress it all into this presentation, so this basically is just kind of a summation of the whole thing.
Well, hello Boston, you're around St. Paul, about to go ring some pups. That is going to be my assistant today, showing the ropes. Try to keep yourself safe using this Kevlar gear, top of the line. It keeps those pups from biting through your skin. So take care of Boston and see you soon.
Drive a chrome,
crying all yellow.
Dark radio screams in me. I see little girl. Rust that little
I'm
doing the shearing? Is it just to make them more visible, or?
Yeah, because basically they don't have any vector to count just 25 pups. They need to have some way to reference, you know, some way to identify the population. So to go out and just blindly count animals, you can't count them all because they hide under rocks. Sometimes they go out to the water, so they need basically a ratio, and they need some way to mark them. So you go out and mark 10% with the theory that if they go back out and recount them, if they count one pup that's sheared for every 9 pups that aren't, then that population stayed the same from 2 years ago. And if they're not counting that ratio, then you know the population is shifting. So they found that to be the easiest way to mark them.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome. Anybody else?
You mentioned that an American population and a Russian population, are those two isolated from each other?
They are isolated. There is a little bit of shifting, they think, during the breeding, right after the breeding season, because the islands are close enough, but not very much. They haven't found, I'm not sure how much research is being done in the Russian population. It's really hard to find some studies on that, but there isn't any tags that are coming over from the other coast. So. Any other questions? Thank you, everyone.